everyone, welcome back to another week on my YouTube channel. I am the owner and artisan behind Brush by Brandy. My name is Brandy, and this week we're going to be working on this chest that's behind me. So this one was actually kind of funny because I found it on Facebook Marketplace when I was out and about. It was out for free on the curb, and I never get those curb finds. I'm always the person that misses out on them. So I ran over and it was still out there and I grabbed it. I didn't grab it. I had to manhandle it into the back of my SUV because it's actually really a lot bigger than I expected, but I got it in there and I got it home. And it's a beautiful piece in beautiful condition. So I feel like the luckiest person ever because that never happens to me. But I'm going in kind of a pretty direction. We're going to use a redesign with Prima moulds this week, as you can see by this half of my piece. And we're using a new paint this week from Good Bones Paint, as you can see by this half of my piece. This piece is yin and yang. Can you guys see it? We're going to add some color to these cherry blossom molds. It's going to be beautifully ornate. It's going to have the balance of the light and the dark. I'm really excited to work on this with you guys. So if you guys want to see all these processes and how this chest started and what it's going to look like at the end, you guys stick with me through this whole video. We're going to do some cool techniques and let's go ahead and get started on this one. Here's where I started with this piece. I actually picked this one for free off the curb, which never happens to me. I'm going to take my inspiration for this one from some redesign with Prima molds using cherry blossom florals, and then I'm going to be pulling out some Good Bones paint in the colors of coyote and pebble and highlighting them with some hibiscus from Daydream Apothecary. The bright pink flowers against these neutrals will really make those flowers pop. I'm ready to start off my paint process on this Bombay chest, but the first thing I want to do is give it a good cleaning. I'm going to spray it down with some TSP. TSP is trisodium phosphate, and it's a hardware store item that you dissolve into water. It's a very thorough cleaning. It's going to remove any finger grease and then any cleaner residue, anything like pledge. That's what I'm trying to get off of this piece. It's fairly modern and it's not particularly dirty. It actually cleans up really well. And then I want to make sure that I rinse down all of my cleaning residue just using a spritz of water. I'm also going to take the drawers out and I'm going to vacuum out the inside of the piece, make sure I get all that, and this will be ready to begin my paint process on. This piece does have a fairly shiny finish on it, so I want to go ahead and give it a good scuffing. I'm going to take my surf prep sander, and for scuff sanding, I like to use one of their padded sponges, and this is a medium grit. And I'm just going to go over the entire surface of my piece and just take down some of the gloss of this finish. Once I'm done with my scuff sanding, I make sure I come back and re-wipe my piece down to remove any sanding residue. All right, I am here and we're actually going to teach my son Noah how to do a resin pour using redesign with Prima molds and amazing casting resin from Alumilite. Say hi, Noah.
Hello.
Okay, so let me show you the first things, which is what I get out every time I'm going to pour some resin. This is my resin station. I've covered it in silicone mats. Now, these get pretty beat up. They're not brand new, but silicone mats just protect my workstation, and then the resin just can peel off anytime I feel like cleaning them. All right, I use as many silicone tools as I can. So these are silicone cups here, and these are nice for cleaning out. I've got silicone stir sticks. And these will clean easily too. The resin just pulls right off of them. I've got silicone gloves on my hands. A lot of people can have sensitivities to resin, so you want to make sure you protect yourself. And then I've got silicone molds that I'm going to be using. Anytime I do a pour, I get out two molds. And this is the one that I actually want to use over here. But I've got this one out. It's got some small details on it because I usually end up pouring maybe a little too much and I don't want it to go to waste. You want to make sure your workspace is nice and level. This is my amazing casting resin from Alumilite, and it comes in two parts, a part A and a part B, and we're going to mix equal parts of each. I store mine in these FIFO bottles, and it makes it really easy when I'm ready to do a pour. So this is going to be my mixing cup, and I'm going to measure in this cup. So I'm going to pour roughly equal parts of each, and I'm going to pour them into my mixing cup. I'm going to make sure this is as cleaned out as I can get it. Okay, that was my part A, and now I'm going to do my part B. And these bottles make it really easy to store my resin. Now, Amazing Casting Resin is very forgiving in that if I mix it slightly off the ratios, it will still set up. All right, I've poured both my A and my B into this one cup, and now I'm going to stir it. And I only want to stir it for about 30 seconds because it's going to start setting up very quickly. You can see how that turned kind of a milky white. Once the milkiness goes away, those are adequately mixed, and I want to start pouring. If I wait too long, I will end up with a casting of my cup. Now I'm going to use the spout on my cup, and I'm going to pour this into my mold. I want to make sure it's on a flat surface, which this mat has some stuff on it, so it's kind of hard to find a flat spot. I'm just going to move it over to this spot here. All right. And I'm going to drizzle it into my mold. And I want to move fairly quickly. If you take too long, your resin will start setting up. I want to at least make sure I get it in there before it starts setting up. This is a 10-minute casting resin, which means in 10 minutes it's going to be ready to remove from the mold. All right, so that's about filled my mold up. I'm going to get this stem right here. And I've got a little tiny bit extra, which is why I get out my extra mold. I think I can do like one keyhole. All right, I've drizzled it all out of my cup. Now I'm going to come back with one of my silicone stir sticks, and I'm just going to push the resin into my mold. So I'm visually going over the entirety of my mold. That one went really nice. It found all the corners for me. This one's a little shallow, so I'm just going to feed the mold using my silicone stir stick. All right. Resin is a heat reaction, and so the warmer your temperatures are, the faster it's going to start setting up. But let's go ahead and we're just going to watch these cure. While this one finishes curing, after watching me do one round, I'm going to go ahead and let my 14-year-old Noah do his first resin pour. Let's watch how he does. He actually ended up doing really good at this. The only thing I had to warn him about after his first go round was to try to not overfill the molds. It can cause the backs to kind of get a hump in them, and then they can be hard to attach to your piece. But other than that, he did fabulous. I am incorporating two molds in this, and it made it much easier to pour because I was able to use both. They are both cherry blossom designs, and they're both from Redesign with Prima. They're just slightly varying, and it allowed me to have more variation on my furniture piece. Once my resin has turned completely white, I flex my mold around the edges of the resin, and I'm able to pop it right out of the mold. The more you let these set up, the easier they are to remove from the mold. I'm actually popping these out a little prematurely because I want them nice and soft so that I'm able to bend and flex them around the curves of my piece. When the resin is first removed, it's nice and soft and flexible, and that's the best time to attach it when you've got curves on your furniture piece. The more it sets up, the harder it's going to get. You can apply a little bit of heat to the resin and it will soften slightly, but it's never as bendy as it is when you first remove it. I'm going to go ahead and use some Tight Bond Quick and Thick adhesive, and I'm just going to apply these over the front of my furniture piece. My son sat there and cast molds while I applied them, and I was able to just keep applying the fresh molds to the front of my piece as they came out. It actually went fairly quickly. I would say for the entire front of this piece, I ended up using about 5 castings of each of the two molds. Having a helper to do this while you're applying so many molds was definitely a huge advantage. My resin molds are all attached. I'm going to go ahead and leave those be and let that glue dry overnight before I apply any paint. So let's go ahead and turn this to the side and we'll get some paint on the sides. I'm using Good Bones paint, and this first color I'm laying out is the dark gray, which is called Pebble. In the center, I'm going to go ahead and put some Coyote, and then I'm going to work the two together. I make sure and I dug the pebble into all the details of this piece so that those are all covered. This is just my base coat, so I'm really just getting my colors laid out. The blend on this coat does not have to be perfect. On my base, I started with a 2-color blend. I did end up adding a little bit of white to the center of this for even a lighter tone. So you probably noticed that when I attached all my molds, I didn't worry about the spaces in between my drawers. So as of right now, my drawers don't open. I needed to come back after my molds and the glue were nice and dry, and I'm going to cut them in the spaces between the drawers using an oscillating saw. This one's made by DeWalt. This will allow me to just get the drawers open so I can separate them, and then I will need to come back and sand the edges of this so that they're nice and smooth.
My molds and my glue are nice and dry. Let's go ahead and put some paint on these molds. It did take quite a bit of time to dig the paint into the molds. I'm doing a lighter color on one side of the piece, so that's going to be my coyote over the molds, and it's going to fade into the dark gray as it goes over to the other side. I'm using a Klingon S50 brush, and I'm just making sure that I dig it into all those details and crevices. This two-color blend was really pretty, but I did end up taking a little bit of Daydream Apothecary in their pure white, which is called Ground Control, and I just added that into a little bit of the coyote to give me a lighter shade, and then I turned this into a three-color blend. Tops are always a challenge when you're doing a blended finish, and that's because they're these big, wide open spaces. And here are my best tips when you're working on a top. Number one, you've got to work quickly. You need to keep your arm moving, keep this paint moving. It's going to start to set up and you've got to pay attention to the entire top. My other tip is keep your paint wet. The more you keep it wet, the longer it's going to stay in play, and you can keep working the top as long as your paint stays moist. I started with the pebble around all my edges, which is this nice dark gray, gave myself a basic outline, and then I came into the center and I added a little bit of my coyote for kind of a highlighted finish in the middle. Then I took my coyote that I added a little bit of the white to and made that my very center color. That's my lightest tone. I also find on these large open surfaces that using kind of a swirling motion to pull those colors together really helps to get the colors moved into each other. And then I can come back and just smooth them out with a dry clean brush and get my colors moved into each other. All right, now I've got a great base on all of my sides. Let's go ahead and put the final coat on this side here. I'm going to follow my same step. So I'm going to outline the edges using my dark gray, and then I'm going to come in with a little bit of my coyote, and the very center is going to be my coyote mixed with the white. This is my second coat, so I do use a little more time working my blend together. Once I've got all my colors laid on, I come back with my brush and I'll swirl the colors into each other and then smooth them out. All right, this part is kind of cool because I haven't showed you guys this in quite a long time, but I'm going to be using some artisan powders. So these are memory hardware artisan powders, and this color is a soft pink. I'm just going to use a watercolor brush and apply it around the edges of my florals, and then I'm going to wipe away the excess. I'm doing this on top of raw unsealed paint, and what it's going to do is it's going to leave me this soft pink glow just around the very edges of my flowers. It's very, very subtle, but it actually turns out really beautiful on the final finish. How the powders work is I first applied a little bit of my Good Bones wax, which is a nice clear wax, over just the tops of my flowers. This gives the powder something to embed into. That's how they stay permanent to your piece. So the powder is going to embed into my clear wax, and then I can buff it away so there's nothing left on my surface. I do recommend starting at the top when you're working with powders. They do tend to flow down to the bottom in sort of a snowflake effect, and so you're going to end up with a little bit of a mess underneath you. And so just start at the top and then they'll just flow down. You don't want that to land on your already finished parts. A little bit of powder goes a long way, and these are actually made for a very subtle effect, so it doesn't take a lot to get it. And you want to make sure you buff away all your excess. These come in several colors. I'm using a soft pink here. You could use a green. They have brown, black, pretty much any color that you want. The artisan powders are from Prima Marketing, but they're not in the redesign line. These are actually considered a mixed media product, but I like to use them on furniture. They're actually beautiful here. So it's really fun to find other crafting supplies that you can use and incorporate them into furniture finishes. With my powders all done, I did pull my drawers out. I probably should have done this sooner, but I'm going to go ahead and take my surf prep sander and I'm just going to sand those edges where I had cut my molds and make sure that they're nice and smooth. You want to make sure your glue is nice and dry and adhered before you do this. And then I just touched up my edges with a little bit of the coordinating paint color.
All right, I love my florals. They are absolutely beautiful. A little bit of my dust has collected, so I'm just going to give them a nice little dusting off so they're nice and clean. And I just want to bring out some of the raised points on here. And I'm going to kind of mix a custom coral color that's a little bit brighter than what my powders are. And the colors I'm going to be using are Lemon Shark and Hibiscus from Daydream Apothecary. So all I'm doing is I'm just going to take this little sample stick of wood and I'm going to give myself a little bit of paint in each color. And I just want enough to color my brush. And I don't care if it's the same color every time. I'm actually going to give myself a little bit more hibiscus because I want it to kind of stand out. The Lemon Shark tones it down and makes it a sort of corally color. And I'm just going to hit the edges of these flowers. I'm using a natural bristle artist brush. And I'm just dry brushing the very edges of these molds.
Once I finished dry brushing in my mix of hibiscus and lemon shark, I came back with a little bit of scuba girl and hit just the very edges of my flowers with that. This gives me three colors total that's on my flowers. I've got the soft pink of the Memory Hardware Artisan powders. And then I've got this mix of the hibiscus and then my scuba girl on the very edges. And so even though I didn't hand paint each one of these flowers, I just did some quick dry brushing. They've got an incredible amount of detail. The final look really makes each flower look like it was hand painted. I also used a little bit of my artisan powder in black and I just hit the edges of the stems and that way those had some dark brown color too. I also added the dark brown to the center of my flowers so those match the stems. Here's some photos for comparison. You can really see what I started with just the soft pinks, and then in the next photos when I added the purple to the edges of the flowers, how much detail it really made them pop against the light colored background. With all my paint finishes just about wrapped up on this piece, I want to go ahead and get started on my final touches, but I'm going to go ahead and give this a quick clear coat first. I'm going to use the Dream Coat from Daydream Apothecary. This is a beautiful low luster finish and I'm just wiping it on using a blue sponge. Good Bones paint is not required to be sealed, but I did add it because it does add that little bit of low luster sheen that I really love. Let's pay some attention to the hardware. I gave these a really good cleaning and then I'm just going to go over them with a spray paint. This also includes a primer. My next final touch is going to be to add some wax details. I'm just going to ride some black wax in the very crevices of my drawers just to give a little bit of shadowing to them. Once I applied the black wax, I come back and buff it away with the dry rag. I slowly worked my way around the drawer edges and then onto the sides of the piece. I also added a little bit of silver gilding wax from Redesign with Prima around my drawer boxes.
It is staging time for this piece and I'm super excited. I love staging my pieces. It's kind of when you get to see them all dressed up in their Sunday best. So what did I choose for staging this one? Well, I chose to use some sort of screen art and they reminded me of a very Japanese shoji screen, which kind of suits the cherry blossoms. Those are, traditionally a Japanese variety. And then I used some cherry blossoms for my plants. I only had white. I probably would have preferred pink, but white it's gonna be. My vase is silver to pull out the silver detailing on this. And then my artwork is gray. So everything kind of ties together. It's simple and clean and just lets the detail of the piece shine. Well, I had originally tried my white cherry blossoms for my floral, but when I tried to take my photos, they kind of disappeared into the background. So I traded them out with some pink peonies. I really wish I had pink cherry blossoms, but I don't. So pink peonies it is.
And here are my final photos of this piece. You guys, I love how it turned out. Those molds really make it. They're incredibly detailed. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. You can find links for everything I use in the description for this post. As always, you can find more Brush by Brandy on Facebook, Instagram, Pinterest, YouTube, and on my website at brushbybrandy.com.